All right, guys, in today's video, we want to talk a little bit about two incidents that happened. One happened last night and one happened this morning. I want to talk about it. Bit of a coincidence, but still, nevertheless, we're going to talk about it. My name is Sham. This is Zero X5s. The truth is always out there. As I always say, everything I've said here is like a public record. So, yeah, please do hit that like button, smash that subscribe button, or do the opposite. Doesn't matter, right? If you have to, smash that phone if you have to. But believe me, all of this information that you're going to get here is quite valuable, right? So let's get into this, right? So something happened quite weird. BTC, a lot of people didn't even realize this because it didn't happen across the board, right? BTC actually had a flash crash last night and it crashed down all the way to $8,900, right? So quite surprising. In fact, the person who was responsible, or the people who are responsible to dump it to such a low price, they did it over 3.5 hours. They lost potentially around $4 million. The entire trade was worth about $55 million, but if you do the maths and if you pick it up again at $8,900, just imagine how many more BTC you got. So the trade originally started with about 400 Bitcoin. Obviously there's a bit of a loss there, but in total they benefited about 1,000 BTC, right? Now you got to wonder, why would somebody go and try and sell $55 million over a span of 3 hours in a low liquidity exchange? You've got the big boys out there. You've got Coinbase, you've got Binance, you've got etc, right? You've got all of those boys out there. So why would you choose Bitmex, right? A company which is originally formed in Hong Kong, right? But then currently now registered in Seychelles, right? Cayman Islands, I believe. Well, that's where, what's his name? Raoul Paul lives, I believe. Anyway, so Seychelles, right? Again, another company that was also there way back in the days was, what was his name? FTX, right? That was there too. Anyway, we're not going to go into all of that integrity, right? The point is someone's realized that they can go to a low liquidity exchange, right? Have a buy order, right? So if you've got $100 million to burn, what do? You go and you put a buy order for 50% of whatever you have, and then you put a sell order and you force the market price in an exchange, and then just dump the price down so you can rebuy while you create panic in the market, rebuy the same coins for a lot less, right? And then double your stash, right? So double, triple, quadruple in this case, right? So that's what happened. Brilliant scam. I have to give hats off, right? And I know it's a massive manipulation. The exchange has come out on Twitter and everything as well, and they have also confirmed this. They said, look, we believe there's been a misconduct. We believe that there are some people who are responsible, and apparently their accounts have been frozen. Now, they haven't confirmed if it's been frozen after they withdrew the fund or before they withdrew the fund. So we'll see, right? They're currently investigating these accounts on how they managed to do this, right? Because so clearly they are open about it as well. They're saying, look, there's been a misconduct. There's definitely been a manipulation there, and they did this. But it didn't affect the market because it was a one-off thing that happened. Now, over 3.5 hours happening in a single exchange, I'm surprised the entire BTC market didn't track that. I'm surprised. So that means a lot of the data that we're tracking is not 100% accurate, right? Or Bitmex is not operating on the blockchain. Whatever the case is anyway, right? If it was a blockchain buying on a spot market, that would have impacted the entire industry. So in a sense, I'm kind of glad and I'm shocked at the same time. So I'm glad that they're not doing it on the blockchain, because if they did, they would have fucked everybody, excuse my language, but they didn't. So I'm quite happy. A few hours later, anyway, the next coincidence, right? So the coincidence, let's just say the coincidence, right? In the UK, we've got Financial Conduct Authority, US, come out, and they said in the UK, basically, Financial Conduct Authority, FCA, came out and says, oh, we got to create some sort of a thing where we can protect investors, right, from these crypto manipulation, in layman's term, right? So clearly something has happened, something's triggered, and I think a lot of people lost a lot of money. I think a lot of institutions or whatever, whoever are in bed with FCA, have said, look, go and sort it out, because unless you create some sort of a law to protect us, we're fucked. But remember, they won't listen to you and me, right? The whole thing is they won't listen to you and me. You and me, general public, we're their pawns, right, in the game, right? So we can go, right? The kings and queens and all the, you know, knights and whatever you want to call in the chessboard, right? They want to protect them. And there are people out there with enough power, you know, financial power, whatever you want to call it, or influence, that they can actually get the FCA to announce something immediately, right? And actually get them to start working, because they won't do it for the people. You know that, right? They won't do it for the people. It's just an act. Oh, we're trying to protect the people. No, they're not trying to protect anybody. The Financial Conduct Authority does not protect the people, right? They do not protect the people, right? They basically just try and make money off the institutions and whatnot. And all they're trying to do is protect the bigger investors. That's what it is, right? So that's what's happened. I just thought it was a freaking brilliant coincidence that this happened. And it happened in one single exchange in Seychelles, right? So not even in the UK, but UK made this announcement before everybody else, right? I just thought, well, that's kind of weird. But hats off, as I said, hats off to the people who figured it out, because it's something I've talked about before as well in some really, really old video. It doesn't actually take much people to go and manipulate the price. And I've talked about what the method would be. And funnily, they actually did it. So I think there's a video about 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago, we made. And funny thing is, they did it. They had a buy order at a very low level where they intended the market to go. They didn't have to buy at that exact price, but as long as they got it less than what they sold it for, they're winners. They're winners. They could in the process lose $4 million, not a problem. But they came back with 1,000 BTC. 1,000 BTC's worth a lot of money. A lot of money. So that's what happened this morning. And that's probably one of the reasons why other people started to panic, because obviously Twitter explodes and everything else explodes. So I think other people started to panic a little bit, and they started also dumping the price. Now, one other thing I've noticed is they've dumped the price below the 21-day moving average. Now, that's not a good sign. That's not a good sign, right? I don't want to see it there. Believe me, I do not want to see it there, because that brings our 21-day moving average down a little bit. Now, there is some good things and bad things into this as well, right? So there is a maths that only one other person I know that does it, right? And according to his maths, he has, so I'm talking about Plan B, he's got this stock to flow chart. And based on the stock to flow chart, right now we should be around $50,000. Coincidentally, the charts also say $50,000. In fact, let's be more precise, about $49,000, right? So there's a range it talks about, that it needs to be within that range. And he's okay with that as well. I'm okay with that as well. So that's the only other person I've seen who talks about it, right? My maths gave me around 58,000 to 54,000. So I have a range between 58 to 54. Now, obviously his chart is done, pre-done. So he's doing a forecast. I don't necessarily do a forecast. I just take the chart data and I'm like, okay, this is where I've got to be. So I kind of stick to certain numbers that I talk about. And I'm like, guys, this is a probability. Now, why is it a probability? I think I mentioned something on Discord. I said, I'm surprised nobody's asked me why I'm sticking to 58K, right? Yes, I've said the number, and I did say that I can't prove it to you on a chart because it doesn't exist on a chart. What is it? Let me explain to you what it is, right? So on this video, I'm going to explain this, and hopefully people will make sense to you, right? And it's kind of related to what Plan B sees as well. So every 4 years, we have a halvening, right? And we have a pattern. We follow that pattern exactly to the dot, right? So accurate. We follow it every single time. And we can see those patterns, how it plays. So we pump a little bit, then we dump before the halvening, and then we pump forward. But we've never, ever broken the trend and created an all-time high before a halvening. So that's where the plan kind of broke, right? Now, if I see something that is pumping and it's on a pumpamental, forget it. I don't care. So all I'm going to say is, guys, just be careful. Stop loss. Now you guys probably understand why I've been so freaking adamant about it. Because I'm going to stop. You know, at some stage, I'm going to say, don't care about stop loss anymore. Does that make sense? But there was a massive reason behind it, because I'm seeing all patterns being broken. And remember what I tell you, if we see patterns break, we're lost. We're clueless. I am clueless. It doesn't matter how much of a super expert chart analyst you are, you cannot predict that future. It doesn't happen. I never call it a prediction anyway. I call it a projection. You cannot do that. You can only go by the data that is given to you. And that was a data that we didn't have. So here we are in a complete different zone. We do not have that data. We've got no reference points to work on and look for a pattern. Pattern didn't exist. Okay, fine, let's go. We're going to go parabola, right? So, of course, we need to trade it responsibly. If we're going to buy, we're going to sell, do whatever we need to do, we need to do it responsibly. Hence why I kept on saying stop loss. So, anyway, so one of the patterns that we know regarding this halvening is that it pumps up to a certain level, but it should not go above a certain level. So right now, according to Plan B, we should not be above $50,000. Anything above $50,000 is dangerous. according to my maths, we shouldn't be anything above $54,000 to $58,000. Hence why I've stuck to that number, right? Now, why do I stick to this number? Because if I see the number, everyone else sees the number, Plan B also sees the number, and all the other big institutions that are paying millions of dollars, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars, are also seeing this number. So all the experts around the world, they see that number. They're like, ooh, actually, no, we just pumped it a bit too much. Maybe the hype was a bit too much. Let's bring the market down, right? Let's keep the market, bring the market down, create a bit of fear so we can buy a little bit more discount, but also control the narrative, because right now we're gone out of control. Because sometimes what happens when the pump mental starts, it doesn't matter who you are, a bear, a bull, a massive whale, a trillionaire, it doesn't matter. You can't control the narrative, because once the pump starts, I call it the pump machine, right? There's no stopping it. It just keeps on coming and pumping and pumping and pumping. And that's when you lose control. So control was lost for a bit. Control was lost for a bit. And personally, to be honest, I'm quite happy to see it come back down to test a little level. I don't care if it goes to 58K, by the way, guys, please understand this. I do not want it to go to 58K, right? But that's what the pattern says. Anything above that, I'm okay with, right? Ideally, I want to stay above the 21-day. Even if we touch the 21-day moving average, I'm okay with that. Even the 30-day, I'm okay with that. Does that make sense? Even a 30-day moving average, I'm okay with that, right? What we don't want to see is go back to touch the 50-day moving average. We don't want to go to the 100-day, obviously, right? So those are the patterns we do not want to see, because if we do, then we're going to lower numbers, right? And this is going to be a bigger correction. It's going to prolong this entire cycle a little bit more. And then we come into a zone. And you know, I don't like zones, because when you enter a zone, trading zone, right? A price range, it becomes complicated, because you don't know if you're going to go up, if you're going to go down. And I've always been transparent about that. I'm not trying to be a guru here. I'm not trying to be the big boss here. It's like, say, right, this is what's going to happen. No, I am lost. Sometimes the chart doesn't speak to me, especially when we enter a range. The chart will not speak to me, right? I know it sounds kind of cringy and kind of stupid, but what I'm trying to say is I cannot see a pattern anymore. When I can't see a pattern, I am freaking lost. I am lost. So, you know, I've been kind of observant and watching the market carefully. Of course, the market dumped and came back and is now kind of trying to get back above a nice little level, currently hovering around the 64, which is good, because then we did have a $63,000 level, which if we can hold tonight, it's not a bad deal. Tomorrow we can actually start attempting to make a pump, right? Recover a little bit. Is our opportunity to buy the dips, right? But again, buying the dips is something, normally I would say buy the dips. Right now, if you buy the dips, stop loss. Make sure you have a stop loss, right? If you don't, then we're not in a safe zone at this present moment. But again, I kind of stand by another thing I've said in a live stream recently as well. A couple of days ago, I made a live stream. I think it was about 3 days ago. And I'm going to stand by that as well, that guys, the market's not over. I don't think the market's over yet. And I think all the bloodbath that we could possibly have has already happened. So right now, if you're thinking about, oh, is it going to bleed even more? Probably not, but most likely not, because we've already had a nice little 14-15% dump. In fact, if you take into account the 8,900, then it's been a freaking 90% dump. You know what I mean? So just kind of look at it that way. But don't be over bullish. Don't go around buying coins. Oh, I'm going to hodl this coin. Or if you've bought it, I hope you didn't hodl, right? Because I told you guys that stop loss, whatever you buy, stop loss, right? When the pump momentums happen, it doesn't matter what the coin is. We do not fall in love with the coins. We do not do anything. Liquidations is much more better for us, right? If we can get liquidated and stopped out, even on our stop loss, on the spot buys. I'm not even talking about leverage, guys. Forget leverage. This is not to do with leverage. If you have coins on spot market, you've made money and you've been stopped out. Well, now you've got an opportunity to rebuy those coins, if not buy something else and move forward. I don't know how many of you guys noted exactly what time I posted the message on Discord to say, and you can go, I know a lot of you guys are on Discord, go and watch, go and look at that comment I sent on Discord. I actually did it a few minutes after that. So I sent a message and I said, I'm actually going to come out of my leverage trade for Solana, right? Go and look at the price, right? I said, I want to lock my profits. I want to come out. I'm going to wait. That's it. I'm closing my trade. I'm going to wait. Why? I waited. The market came back to me. Does that make sense, right? The market actually came back to me. But am I going back in yet? No, I'm still kind of not too confident yet. I need to be more confident. Solana, I'm going to just tap it and I'll tell you, it did create a lower low. In fact, the entire market created a lower low, and that's something I do not like. I do not like to enter a zone when I see a lower low. I would rather have a confirmation to say that this low is not valid anymore. Let's move up. In fact, a good thing about Solana is it didn't go to its, I'm looking at it right now, it didn't go to its 21-day moving average, which is a great thing. We're way above that. I'm really, really happy. In fact, its 21-day moving average currently today, the price is approximately 152, 153. That's its 21-day moving average. We didn't go, so I'm okay with that. But BTC fell through. So we need to recover BTC, because remember, it's the most dominant coin out there, right? So the most dominant coin does have power over the entire market to move the market up or down. So I would love to see BTC recover, and I would love to see none of this nonsense anymore. I hope, and I did see actually, I also posted something on Discord. A lot of people are currently buying the dips. So there was a lot of buys. Of course, a lot of people are also trying to long the market as usual. Oh my days, I just don't know what to say, right? So yeah. It is a product, people are going to use it. Unfortunately, most people don't learn from their mistakes. And it's usually the same offenders. So, you know, what can we say, right? But I hope all of you guys understand that the market is not over. From what I'm seeing so far, yes, we are in a particular danger zone, falling below the 21-day moving average. And I'm talking about simple moving average, nothing too exponential or anything like this. Simple moving average. That does bring into us a bit of danger zone. And let's see, I mean, we just need to finish this week. I think this week's going to be a very important week for us. So I'm now talking about the future. Forget that what happens in the next couple of days. None of that really matters, in my opinion. I think we need to close this week in order for us to decide what we're going to do. All right. So until then, stay calm, stay patient, stay safe. Don't buy stuff. You know, if you are going to FOMO, of course, you FOMO on a bloody day. This is a great opportunity, but make sure to do it with a stop loss. I cannot tell you enough. I beg you guys, do a stop loss. You will see the benefit of it. Right? You will understand why this guy bangs on about stop losses, right? You know, what the hell is his deal, right? You'll understand this. And I'm sure by now you have all understood what my whole point was. So other than that, I'm not going to make this video any longer. I was not intended to make this video over 17 minutes. It was going to be about 10 minutes. But I hope you got the information. I hope you understand what's going on right now. Just before I leave, I'll tell you the time and date for reference. The time now is 4:46. The date is the 19th of March, 2024. If you have watched it to here, I really, really appreciate it. Please do hit that subscribe, hit that like button, share with one other if you find value, and leave something in the comments so I know that you have watched it to the end, right? Market currently sitting at $2.36 trillion. Honestly, I'm not too fussed about it. It doesn't matter. Anything above 2 trillion, I'm okay, right? I know it's a freaking big number, but yes, I'm okay. $64,700 right now for BTC. So it is recovering. It did go down to $62,444, which was a line that I drew recently, and it actually touched that line. Again, I'll show you a picture if you want on Discord. Ethereum sitting at 3,300. I'm not too concerned about Ethereum right now. Ethereum will perform, if not outperform BTC, provided BTC can stay green and stable. It will be fine, right? Solana's holding strong at 182. I'm not complaining. So I hope this video was informative. Let me catch you guys on another one very soon. Adios, my amigos.